Hi, this is Jim Pewter. He's here. Dickie Goodman.
We interrupt this record to bring you a special bulletin. The reports of a flying saucer hovering over the city have been confirmed. The flying saucers are real.
Real, well, I feel what my heart can't conceal.
That was the Clatters recording. Too real. We switch you now to our on-the-spot reporter downtown.
Come on, baby, let's go downtown.
Take it away, John. Man, has this reporter reeling?
Here I go reeling.
That was the Clatters again with their big one. Uh-oh.
This is John Cameron, Cameron again downtown. The spaceman has returned to his ship and is taking off. We return you now to our studios.
The flying saucer has gone. There is no threat of an invasion. However, the flying saucers are still around.
That was it, the original Flying Saucer Part 1. This is Jim Pewter, and he's still around making funny records these days, just as he did back in 56. Welcome, Dickie Goodman.
Hi, Jim. Yeah.
That's fun. Every time I hear that, I'm looking at the original record that I bought as a kid, you know, back in the Midwest, Luniverse label. When this thing hit, Dickie, it was just phenomenal. How did you come up with the idea for the Flying Saucer?
I was sitting around with a fellow. We were writing some songs, Bill Buchanan and I, and all of a sudden, I don't know why it hit me, I said, how would it be a disc jockey show being interrupted by reports of a flying saucer? So I said, the flying saucers are real, and then too real when I failed. Yeah. From there on, we didn't know any better, so we put the thing together.
So we went in the studio, and you got some of the hit records, and
right,
you spliced them
together.
It's kind of interesting, because back in the late 30s, of course, Orson Welles did The War of the Worlds.
Right.
And this had an impact that was, of course, it didn't cause people to jump out of windows or anything, but everyone got behind it. It was such a big hit. Let's do part two, and then we'll talk a little bit about some of the problems that came about with the flying saucer, okay?
Great. Sure.
You ready? John Cameron Cameron, right?
Sure.
We are not going to interrupt this record. Yes, we are. The flying saucer has landed again. Washington, the Secretary of Defense has just said...
Be that ashamed.
That was Skinny Dynamo's record. That's a shame.
This is John Cameron Cameron Part 2. Gathered around me are several of the spacemen. Tell us, have you come to conquer the world?
Snap at the earth, look at me.
And now would you repeat that in English?
Don't want the world to have and hold.
The saucers will always be there.
Always be there.
Goodbye, Earth people.
That's that little guy. How did you speed up his voice in those days? That was kind of unique.
We wrapped the spindle on the tape machine.
Because, you know, a couple years later, David Seville out here on the coast got the Chipmunks together with that concept. Okay, the Flying Saucer, Part 1 and Part 2. This is Jim Pewter with my special in-person guest, Dickie Goodman. He's going to be with me today and tomorrow, and you're going to be hearing The Touchables and Kong and the Banana Boat story, and we'll even get to Mr. Jaws and Ben Crazy as we go along. But it's an interesting way to make a living, Dickie, you know what you do.
My mother still says to me, she said, don't you work, though? Don't you have a job?
Here's my new record, Mom.
Right, that's right.
What did she say when she first heard that record that you did, The Flying Saucer?
She figured
saucer?
I'd really, you know, why did you quit school for this, you know, type of thing, you know.
After you had the hit, The Flying Saucer in 56, you put out a record called Buchanan and Goodman on Trial. And it was sort of a spoof on some of the, you had some legal problems. What happened? Some of the companies came to you and knocked on the door and said, hey, you didn't ask us? Or
that was it. It had never been done before, so we had about 17 lawsuits. Everybody was suing and trying to get injunctions against the record, and it's just a very frantic time.
What was some of the, anything happened that you had to pull any tune, you know, like out of the disc and recut it? Or
what happened was we went to court and the judge ruled in our favor. He said it's not used in its original form and it doesn't conflict with anybody else's. Nobody can confuse our record if they went out to buy Elvis Presley and bought this instead. So they threw it out of court, and then most people just gradually dropped it. A few people we settled with.
And then you cut this one in 56.
Yeah.
On Trial.
Be on the lookout for Buchanan and Goodman, last seen wearing
black denim trousers and motorcycle boots.
Look out! They're after us!
Let's get out of here!
A
Are you Buchanan and Goodman?
Yes, we are.
Hello, hello again.
Well, this is a summons. You're under arrest.
This is Don Cameron, Cameron in court.
The trial of Buchanan and Goodman is now in session. Is the district attorney ready?
I'm ready. Ready, ready, I'm ready.
Call the first witness.
What is your name?
The upper call is Beetle, but my real name is Mr.
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, have you reached a verdict?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We find them not guilty.
This is John Cameron, Cameron again. And now what are you going to do with that summons? This is John Cameron, Cameron.
And this is the judge saying,
that's all there is to that.
Chapter 2 in the careers of Dickie Goodman, Bill Buchanan. And where's Buchanan now, Dickie?
He lives in Mexico. He imports and exports Mexican jewelry. Believe it or not, it's true.
Have you seen him recently?
I saw him about 2 years ago, you know, when I was living back east.
Okay. I hope he's listening. We got the Kong record coming up next, and I want to ask you also about the Lunarverse label. That was the label you had, the Flying Saucer, the early records on, and how you got that. But first, Americans from many fields of endeavor have given their interpretation of human goals. Baseball great Jackie Robinson put it in these words: I believe in the human race. I believe in the warm heart. I believe in man's integrity. I believe in the goodness of a free society. And I believe that the society can remain good only as long as we are willing to fight for it and to fight against whatever imperfections may exist. What do our human goals mean to you? Check that out. This is Jim Pewter with Dickie Goodman and the Lunarverse label. How did you come up with that name, Lunarverse?
Well, it was originally supposed to be Universe, and then we found out after they started pressing that the name had already been used, and we were standing in the plant, myself, Bill Buchanan, and three or four other guys, because they wanted to get the record out quickly, with a magic marker. We said, we'll make it Loony, Lunar something. We put an L, and making those, there's some of those still around somewhere, there must be a few thousand of them.
You know, it must have been phenomenal meeting the demand for this record, you know, like on your own label, and pressing up quantities like that. Was it difficult meeting the demand, like in certain cities outside of New York?
It really was. I started taking orders on the phone out of a phone booth in a drugstore, Hanson's Drugstore in New York, and I didn't know anything about it. I was taking orders. I had taken orders for maybe half a million. I couldn't press the first copy. How many do you need? And that was it, until we finally got organized.
Dickie, why don't you introduce this next record? It was one of the most recent things you did on Kong. Go ahead.
All right, here's Kong. Very exciting.
We're here on Skull Island, where a 40-foot gorilla has just kidnapped Guan, a young actress. Hey, Kong, what did you tell her?
Tonight.
And what did she say to you?
You've got a cute way of talking.
When do you intend to let her go?
After loving.
Guan, if you can hear me up there, what advice do you have for someone who was kidnapped by a 40-foot gorilla? He's starting to fall. Hey, Kong, you're on my foot. We're falling. Kong, Kong, Kong.
Bye-bye. Boom, right there he goes. Remember the human fly in New York? He climbed up that
right,
building?
That's yeah. Exactly right.
Maybe he got the idea from this record. I don't know, but he didn't fall, of course. Kong, Dickie Goodman. It was on the Shock label?
Shock, yeah.
Yeah. You thought of that name?
No, it was it's Janus Records. Oh. It's one of their companies. Everybody says new record, new label each time.
It's funny. I bet when these records are released, most of the things you've done in your career, they take off right away, don't they, Dickie? Because you do like a current topic that's popular, and
right.
You have to get in there and cut something really quick, because it's like Farrah Fawcett's very big.
Yeah,
and
wallets in somebody's mind. Yeah. Quick, jump in there before they forget about it.
We got the Touchables in Brooklyn next. What caused the split between you and Bill as far as the Buchanan Goodman Records? Then you went on your own. We're going to showcase one here, the Touchables in Brooklyn. He just wanted to get out
of
the business?
He wanted to go in a different direction. Yeah, he really did. He wanted to get out of the business. I guess he had it. It was a little too much.
Tell me a little bit about this one, the Touchables in Brooklyn. What was this based on?
Well, the show, The Untouchables, was very big on TV at the time. And we figured we'll do a takeoff on the Untouchables.
Yeah, it was a big record for you, too.
February 14th, 1929, St. Valentine's Day, in a warehouse on Chicago's South Side.
Members of the Al Cologne gang, disguised as police, gunned down seven of Bugs Moran's boys. Three lived long enough to say,
Gee,
fearing for his life, Moran rushed to LaSalle Street Station, where he was seen boarding a train heading
to Alaska.
At that very moment, Elliot Fress and the Touchables, out to uphold justice, were taking their oath.
Dynamite is the smell.
During the following weeks, 15 members of the Al Cologne mob met violent deaths. Scarmelli Capelli, Cologne's top lieutenant, was cornered by one of Muggs Moran's boys and told,
You're 16, you're beautiful, and you're mine.
Meanwhile, at the headquarters of Elliot Press and the Touchables,
Deine Heimat ist das Meer.
That same day, little Annie Tortoni, Carpelli's gun mall, paid a surprise visit to the Touchables. 2 days later,
they found little Annie with ice.
Clutched in her hand, police found a note with just four words.
You talk too much.
The killings continued until Al Cologne was taken into custody by federal agents. Following his conviction, Cologne told an astonished court,
Like a rubber ball, I'll come bouncing back to you.
This promise was never to be fulfilled. Their job done for them, Elliot Fress and the Touchables turned to each other and said, Now retired and living on the palatial estate of the late Al Cologne, they were asked, how is this possible?
Simple. We were touchable.
Touchables in Brooklyn. Dickie Goodman's my guest. This is Jim Pewter on the Rock and Roll Revival Show. And I wanted to ask you, Dickie, how much, like in the early days, would it cost to do a record like A Flying Saucer?
Well, the very first one cost us, I had about 8 cents, and Bill Buchanan had about 11 in his pocket, and it cost about $600. The only reason, actually, that record really came out is because we owed the studio $600.
Well, from the studio time, like?
From the studio time that we used. Otherwise, we probably never would have come out with it, because everybody, every big company turned us down, you know, just threw us out of the office.
Really?
You
went around, like, to the 1650 Broadway with
right,
it, with all
the companies.
Companies?
And then we had to put it out ourselves. We figured, well, maybe we'll just break even, maybe we made a mistake. Let's get the money back and pay the studio, and we'll go into something else, and it just took off.
I had heard that George Goldner helped you as far as
he really did.
The promotion and distribution. He was one of
the... because otherwise we never would have been... We didn't know anything about the record business. Yeah. You know.
And for the people listening, George was probably one of the best independent producers in the business with Little Anthony, and he had the Chantels. He had that In label with the Little Dog.
Right.
Did you collect a lot of the... Of course, growing up in New York, Dick, you listened to Alan Freed, right?
Right.
Did you collect a lot of the R&B records?
Oh, a lot of them, yeah. A lot of them.
Do you still have your collection?
I still have a lot of them. There's a lot of them that I've given away. People ask me, do you have this record and that? And I give them away, and then I have to try to replace them, which is, you know, real difficult.
Okay, go ahead, Dick. I'm going to have you read a little spot for us. And, and then we got the Banana Boat story coming up.
Looking for somewhere to go, something to do? Why not visit your post, base, or ship library? Chances are you'll find the newest books on the bestseller list or a wide selection of magazines for your reading pleasure. If you want to know specific facts about most anything, your library is the place to go. Remember, your library is just for you, the serviceman. It is stocked, equipped, and managed for you. Visit your library today.
Very good. When's the last time you've been to a library, Dick?
About 4 or 5 weeks ago.
Is that right?
Yeah.
You get your card and it's up to date and everything?
Hell yeah.
Yeah, okay. Let's listen to some more of your fables, should we call it?
Yeah,
all right.
Hillengully Rider, Hillengully, D-A-Y-O.
Tell-tale. Tastes good like a cigarette should.
Yes, friends, and remember,
I love the workman sing this song.
Kong! Kong! Kong!
Bye-bye. Boom, right there he goes. Remember the human fly in New York? He climbed up that
building?
Right,
that's exactly right.
Maybe he got the idea from this record. I don't know, but he didn't fall, of course. Kong, Dickie Goodman. That was on the Shock label?
Shock, yeah.
Yeah. You thought of that name?
No, it was it's Janus Records. It's one of their companies. Everybody says new record, new label each time.
It's funny. I wanted to ask you, Dickie, how much, like in the early days, would it cost to do a record like A Flying Saucer?
Well, the very first one cost us, I had about 8 cents, and Bill Buchanan had about 11 in his pocket, and it cost about $600. The only reason, actually, that record really came out is because we owed the studio $600.
Or from the studio time, like?
From the studio time that we used. Otherwise, we probably never would have come out with it. Because everybody, every big company turned us down, you know, just threw us out of the office.
Really?
We
went around, like, to the 1650 Broadway with it, with all the companies.
And then we had to put it out ourselves. We figured, well, maybe we'll just break even. Maybe we made a mistake. Let's get the money back and pay the studio, and we'll go into something else. And then it just took off.
I had heard that George Goldner helped you as far as
the
promotion and distribution. He was one of
the... because otherwise we never would have been... We didn't know anything about the record business. Yeah. You know.
And for the people listening, George was probably one of the best independent producers in the business with Little Anthony, and he had the Chantels. He had that In label with the Little Dog.
Right.
Did you collect a lot of the... Of course, growing up in New York, Dickie, you listened to Alan Freed, right?
Right.
Did you collect a lot of the R&B records?
Oh, a lot of them, yeah. A lot of them.
Do you still have your collection?
I still have a lot of them. There's a lot of them that I've given away. People ask me, do you have this record and that? And I give them away, and then I have to try to replace them, which is, you know, real difficult.
Okay, go ahead, Dick. I'm going to have you read a little spot for us. And, and then we got the Banana Boat story coming up.
Looking for somewhere to go, something to do? Why not visit your post, base, or ship library? Chances are you'll find the newest books on the bestseller list or a wide selection of magazines for your reading pleasure. If you want to know specific facts about most anything, your library is the place to go. Remember, your library is just for you, the serviceman. It is stocked, equipped, and managed for you. Visit your library today.
Very good. When's the last time you've been to a library, Dick?
About 4 or 5 weeks ago.
Is that right?
Yeah.
You get your card and it's up to date and everything?
Hell yeah.
Yeah, okay. Let's listen to some more of your fables, should we call it?
Yeah,
all right.
Hillen Gully Rider, Hillen Gully. D-A-Y-O.
Tell-tale. Tastes good like a cigarette should.
Yes, friends, and remember,
I love the workman sing this song.
While this is a pleasure,
I'm fattening.
High octane gasoline.
It's not tart, it's not sweet. What a wine, what a treat.
Yes, do as so many do.
Keep your doggy well and strong.
Be completely safe.
By day-o today, Earth people.
That's the Banana Boat story with Dickie Goodman. That's one of my favorite. I bet that took quite a while to get all those commercials.
Yeah, it really did.
What was the most work you've ever done on a product? How long did it take you to complete it? You remember?
I think Mr. Jaws.
Was that right?
Yeah, really did. Because I kept redoing it, hearing little things that I took out and putting back in, and it just took a couple of weeks for some reason.
How do you write something like this, Dickie? What do you're riding around, or you go off somewhere by yourself and sit down like 3 in the morning and come up with these ideas?
Riding around is it.
Is
I get
it?
In my car about 4 or 5 in the morning and just start to just drive around and start thinking of things. I must go through 27 red lights without realizing it, of course, not too healthy.
What do you have, like a little notepad?
Right.
You write everything down?
Yeah. Every time I stop, just write a little something.
Can you come back tomorrow?
Sure.
Because we're going to have Mr. Jaws, and I want to get the Touchables on and Been Crazy. And the most recent thing, Star Wars, right?
Right.
Okay. This is Jim Pewter along with Dickie Goodman moving out. Until tomorrow. Feel like we're in a theater. We're going to get some Hershey's now and some buttered popcorn. Come back for chapter 2 of The Flying Saucers. These are the Tornadoes and Telstar.
This is Dickie Goodman. I'm sitting in here today for Jim Pewter, who couldn't be with us. And let's start the show off with the Touchables.
February 14th, 1929, St. Valentine's Day, in a warehouse on Chicago's South Side. Members of the Al Colon gang, disguised as police, gunned down seven of Bugs Moran's boys. Three lived long enough to say,
"Gee whiz."
Later that evening, Bugs Moran received this anonymous phone call.
"Are you lonesome tonight?"
Fearing for his life, Moran rushed to LaSalle Street Station, where he was seen boarding a train heading
north to Alaska.
At that very moment, Elliot Fress and the Touchables, out to uphold justice, were taking their oath.
Fulfilled.
Their job done for them, Elliot Fress and the Touchables turned to each other and said, now retired and living on the palatial estate of the late Al Colon, they were asked, how is this possible?
Simple. We were touchable.
Oh, I ran out of gas, but I'm here. Thank you, Dickie, for sitting in. It's always great to have you on the show. And I brought along some more of your records, and I just got around the block, and I put $1 worth of gas in. And it, you know, I didn't. I got a couple people pushing right now, but I ran up. Welcome. Thanks for sitting in, opening the touchable segment. I got Mr. Jaws. Someone told me, maybe I read it somewhere, that Mr. Jaws was your biggest record.
Yeah, it was.
It's amazing, because I always thought The Flying Saucer or possibly The Touchables, but of course Jaws was such a big movie. And when did you decide to do something like a satire on Jaws?
Well, when the movie came out, after about a month or so, there were lines around the block, and it was just, that's all everybody was talking about the next day. How many times did you see Jaws? So I finally went to see it, and here's this, it was, you know, it's a frightening picture, and I'm sitting there making little notes and laughing, and people were gradually, they're thinking, who's this nut? They were moving away from me. I'm doing lines, and I'm laughing, and people are looking, and people are screaming in the theater, and I'm making a joke out of it.
So you went in, and then how long did it take to complete the product?
It took a couple of weeks. This took longer than any other record. I don't know why. I kept redoing things and changing them around until I thought it was just about right.
Uh-huh. It's funny because every time I hear this, I have a little girl. She's five, and she comes up to me. She says, "Daddy, do you want to hear me play Jaws on the piano?" And she goes over. She doesn't know a chord, but she just hits the boom, boom, boom.
That's cute.
Here's Dickie Goodman.
We're here on the beach where a giant shark has just eaten a girl swimmer. Well, Mr. Jaws, how was it?
Dynamite!
And what did she say when you grabbed her?
Please.
I know sharks are stupid, but what did you think when you took that first bite?
How sweet it is.
Mr. Jaws, before you swim out to sea, have you anything else to say? With me now is the local sheriff. Sheriff Brody, the shark will be back for lunch. What do you intend to do?
Do a little dance, make a love.
Why are you grabbing my hand?
Wouldn't you give your hand to a friend?
No, wait! Mr. Jaws! That's not the way this record is supposed to end! Help! Help!
That's Mr. Jaws. That's Dickie Goodman. This is Jim Pewter. You know, they have a place on the West Coast called Universal City, and you take a tour, and they take you through, like, the little, like, the ocean part there, and this mechanical jaw comes
right
up. Okay, Dickie, what do you got for us now? Got some news?
Sure. Thinking about what to do when it's time to re-up used to be a hassle, but not anymore. If you're serving in one of the skills that has a shortage, you might be eligible for 12 big ones. Yep, that's right. The new selective reenlistment program can pay you up to $12,000 when it's time to re-up. I guess we're getting it together like the rest of the pros. Re-up, remember, no hassle and maybe a big bonus. To be eligible for the selective reenlistment bonus, you must be serving in a skill with a shortage. Check with your career counselor.
That's great. You read well. That's. I just want everyone to know that's cold. You know, I said, here, if you don't mind, here's a little spot that we do from time to time on the show, and I gave it to Dickie, and he just looked at it. Sure, I'll do it. That was it. Great. I want to thank my good friend Mike Rogers, who's a record collector. He has just about everything that you have recorded through the years. And he called me up a couple of weeks ago, and he said, Jim, he says, Dickie's in town. Why don't you give him a call? And we finally got together, and now we're doing the show. So I thank Mike and you for coming by.
Mike has more records of mine than
is
I
that
have. Yes, he does.
We got Ben Crazy next. Now, this came out during the 60s when the doctor shows were so popular. So we you got your doctor uniform all ready
all
to
set.
Go?
Ready to
okay,
go.
Okay, here's Dickie.
Man, woman, earth, death, infinity.
The scene is an operating room. Assistant doctor, what have you just removed from that patient's stomach?
BP-109.
The operation's a success, doctor, but you've left your rubber gloves inside the patient. Ben Crazy. We've got to find Dr. Crazy. Here come some nurses. A nurse! 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 Where is Dr. Crazy?
Down at Palisades Park.
Better call Dr. Schmorba. He's in the laboratory. Now that the operation is a success, who is Dr. Kildare going to replace at this hospital?
That mule, old Rivers, and me.
That's Ben Crazy. It's The Adventures of Dickie Goodman. This is Jim Pewter, and we've got Frankenstein 59 coming up, and of course, Star Wars is next. And Star Wars is probably the biggest movie in 1977. It's attracting everybody. Everyone's going to the movie. And you went and saw it, and then you came up with an idea, right, Dickie?
Right.
Yeah. What impressed you about the film the most?
I think the effect, just the way they did it. I mean, it was just done so realistically for that type of picture.
Uh-huh. You remember, of course, the old Flash Gordon serials and...
Same way, yeah.
Did you see those as a kid?
Oh, sure, yeah. Every Saturday, went to the theater for a quarter.
Was a quarter?
Yeah.
And they'd continue each week, and you'd come on back. Mm. And I think that's what Star Wars has. It has that... the heroes, I think, are coming back again. Escapism, it's
right.
Fun, and we're getting into outer space and that. And, of course, you've been doing it a long time with the Flying Saucer Records back in the 50s. But how long did this take now to do the Star Wars?
Well, we did it once, and then we decided to recall it and do it over again. So it wound up being in 2-3 weeks.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Let's give it a listen.
We're here on a spaceship where Darth Vader has just kidnapped Princess Leia. Hey, Vader, what do you want to do with the princess?
Just wanna fool around.
Here's C-3PO. 3PO, Darth Vader is coming this way. What are you going to do?
Run, run, run.
3PO! 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 There's little R2-D2. R2, what have you got to say? We are here on the planet Tatooine, where the two robots have just landed. 3POs are attacking the rebels. But listen, the Force!
I'm in you.
Luke has gotten through. He's going to bomb the Death Star. Wait, Luke, I'm still down here. Help!
Star Wars, Dickie Goodman, you even got Darth Vader's breathing in there, Dickie. You're not going to tell me how you got that, though, right?
Well, yeah.
Star Wars. I just want to remind everyone listening that my special in-person guest tomorrow will be Britton Wood. Britton had big hits in the 60s like Oogum Boogum and Give Me a Little Sign and Lovey Dovey Kind of Feeling. He's got a recent side called Come Softly to Me, and that's going to be previewed tomorrow here with Jim Pewter on Thursday and Friday. Special in-person guest, Britton Wood. Right now it's Dickie Goodman, and I got a little spot. I'm gonna read this cold. Like cold in the business means, you know, I've never seen it before. And Dickie, of course, read a couple of spots and no mistakes. Okay, here we go. Did you know that veteran benefits have been around in one form or another since 1636? That's a long time. And that year, the Plymouth Colony passed a law to provide for all men who were disabled while defending the colony. Now, the Plymouth Colony set a trend which has continued to this very day. Now, of course, the Veterans Administration extends a helping hand in such areas as housing and education, as well as pensions and hospital care. Find out about your enlistments today. See personnel or write to the Veterans Administration, 810 Vermont Avenue, Northwest, Washington, D.C., 20420. The Adventures of Dickie Goodman. Mike Rogers, collector of the Buchanan and Goodman and Dickie Goodman songs, brought along an interesting article that was in Time magazine. I'd never seen this before, Dickie. It's from 1956. It has a picture of you and Bill Buchanan with Buchanan and Goodman Flying Saucer T-shirts.
Right.
Can you imagine what they would sell those for today? Do you have any of these?
I have none. I wish I had one.
You know, it's like the comic books. As a kid, I had, you know, like the Superman, the Captain Marvel, and I don't have any of them today. But I was walking down the boulevard, and I saw this bookshop, and they had like the number 3 Superman is selling for like $500.
Amazing.
You know, and it's like records and like these Flying Saucer T-shirts. You know, when I was thinking back yesterday about some of the tunes you did with the Flying Saucer, that was a very popular thing in movies then, wasn't it? The Flying Saucers in the 50s.
Flying Saucers and UFOs at that time. Well, Flying Saucers, they called them at that time.
Yeah. Have you ever seen one?
I never have. Yeah. I'm waiting. I figure, you know, I figure they'll come and get me for sure.
You'll probably be the first one they'll contact, right?
Right?
And it'll be in Time Magazine again. People ask, how can I get a hold of Dickie Goodman Records? You have an album on, is it on the Janus label, the Shock record that's a division of Janus, the Mr. Jaws. That has a lot of your product in it, doesn't it?
Yeah, that does. That has a lot of the old ones.
Yeah. Are you going to put another album together with some more of the sides?
We're coming out with a new one with all new things in it. Going to be something done in all the TV shows, Charlie's Angels and movies, Rocky. It has, you know.
Oh, good. Yeah. I got another one I picked out, a favorite of mine through the years, Frankenstein 59.
Oh, yeah.
Here's Dickie Goodman.
They said it couldn't be done.
Couldn't be done. Couldn't be done. Couldn't be done.
But now, at last, I've created the Frankenstein monster.
This is Count Dracula speaking. The Frankenstein monster has escaped.
Don't try to hide. I'm here, please.
We're here in Washington at a special meeting. Ladies and gentlemen, the president.
Hello, baby.
Mr. President, what happens if the monster cannot be stopped?
Problems, problems, problems.
It looks like all the monster wanted to do was dance with the teenagers.
Oh, baby, that's what I like.
That's of course, the story you've just heard, well...
That's Jim Pewter butting in again. Harold Jenkins, that's Conway Twitty. It's only make-believe, that's Frankenstein 59. And my special in-person guest is Dickie Goodman. Have you done any television shows, Dickie, through the years? It's kind of hard to showcase your tunes, but I was just trying to think maybe you could do it in a film. You know, with cartoon characters, would be funny. Did you ever do any promotion on your records visually?
We did. The only show we did at that time, Perry Como had a TV show. This was when The Flying Saucer was out. And they had all the little puppets made to look like, they were very, you know, one looked like Fats Domino, like Elvis Presley, Little Richard. And we did that show, and it was a disaster. Because after the show, Perry Como was walking by. I said, how was it, Mr. Como? And that same little smile he has, he said, just awful.
Dream along with me,
right? Yeah, right.
We got Luna, right? Luna Tripp.
Luna Tripp.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you, all the labels you've had, there was one name that stuck in my mind. It was Rainy Wednesday Records. How'd you come up with that?
Well, we had a record out at the time, a thing called Superfly Meets Shaft, and the distributor was calling for records, and everybody would think, well, what should the label name be? I said, well, what do you mean? What is the label name? I said, what's today, Wednesday? It's raining outside. That's it, Rainy Wednesday. I mean, let's get the record.
This is Walter Funkheit at Mission Control, downtown Earth. Here with me are astronauts Armstrong, Aldrin, and Collins. What was the first thing you saw when you set foot on the moon?
Oh, me Israelites.
That's very funny.
This is Walter Funkheit.
Who cares?
Mr. Armstrong, what would you say was the strangest thing you saw on the moon?
A boy named Sue.
Hey, we got him. Mike Rogers brought us a Flying Saucer t-shirt. Ardu D2 is with us, and we're blasting off in Dickie Goodman's Flying Saucer. Ready, Dickie?
Ready.
Okay, here we are, how about 5,000 feet up in the air? This is Jim Pewter along with Dickie, and I thank you. What planet this time around, you think?
Oh, we'll take you all the way out in some other galaxy.
Oh, great, okay. Tomorrow I'll be back with Brenton Wood. Until then... Straight ahead. Look at that. Wasn't it? Look at that. Wow. It's a meteorite, right?
Yeah, sure.
Here it comes.
Hey!